Thanks to the Keweenaw Convention and Visitors Bureau for supporting this video.
Hey there, it's story time. So throughout history, copper has been a pretty big deal. I mentioned last week that it's been used in everything from decorations to electronics. And today in the United States, copper is mostly mined out west, in places like Montana, New Mexico, and Arizona. But about 160 years ago, roughly 45% of all copper mined in the United States came from one kind of surprising location, the Quincy Mine in Hancock, Michigan on the Keweenaw Peninsula. They produced more than 700 million pounds of copper from about the 1840s to the 1940s. And at one point, they also set the record for having the longest inclined mine shaft in the world. It stretched nearly 2 miles into the earth, and in the early 1900s, an absolute beast of a machine was built to get people in and out of it. It's called the Nordberg Steam Hoist, and although it isn't operational anymore, it is still the largest machine of its kind on Earth. Today, you can tour the mine and visit the hoist for yourself, but this winter, I also got to go a little deeper than that. I got to learn how the hoist worked, but to really understand the story, I also got to go a few places the public isn't allowed. So, get ready to fall in love with a giant old mining machine. Side note, this is part two of a four-part series. The first video is all about the history of the Quincy Mine and how engineering changed over the nearly a century the mine was active. If you want to watch that video first, you can find a link at the top of the screen here. But if you don't, no worries, you should be able to follow along with this story just fine. All right, off to the mine. Welcome to the Quincy Mine. So, like I mentioned earlier, this place was prolific. They produced so much copper and got their investors' dividends so consistently that the mine got the nickname Old Reliable. And that copper fundamentally shaped life in the United States. It went into electrical wires, bullets, buttons, cannons, pots, and all kinds of other things. Here, workers mined for copper in a number of mine shafts, but the longest was the number 2 shaft. At its peak, it came in at more than 9,000 feet long and reached some 6,200 feet under the surface, making it at one point the longest inclined mine shaft on Earth. And today, it's often the mine shaft people in this area notice first, not because it's some, you know, big hole in the ground, but because of the building on top of it. This is the number 2 shaft rock house. It covers the entrance to the mine shaft and also served as a place where rock could be broken up a little bit and stored after it was pulled from the mine. Today, if you tour the Quincy Mine, you can walk into this building and stand where I'm standing and see where the miners went underground. But with some special help and permission, I got to go a few places that aren't open to the public. For instance, we're going to the top. Now, the views from the top of the shaft rock house are absolutely incredible, but that's not why I'm headed up there. After all, this is a story about a steam hoist. So instead, I'm going to see something else at the top of this building, a set of 2 enormous wheels. These wheels are taller than I am, and they were cast at a local iron foundry. Then they were installed at the top of this building to carry steel cable from way down in the mine out into another building out the window, the number 2 hoist house, which today is home to a sleeping giant. So throughout history, people have gone in and out of mines in all kinds of ways. In the early days of the Quincy Mine, they used a ladder, which was as exhausting and dangerous as you might expect. Then after that, various steam-powered options started showing up. So for instance, you had the man engine, which was kind of like a moving staircase. It was a series of moving platforms, and workers could move from one platform to the next until they reached their destination. Then, as mines got deeper, there came man cars. These were cars that men could sit in and ride above and underground, and they were raised and lowered with the help of steam hoists. On the most basic level, a steam hoist is a big drum that winds and unwinds cable, and the largest one in the world is the Nordberg Hoist, which was completed in 1920. The first time I saw this thing, I was just completely blown away by how big it is. Man, you can read about something all you want, but seeing it in person is a whole different thing. This thing is gigantic. Like other steam hoists, this giant wound and unwound steel cable.
So by extension, it moved carts in and out of the number 2 mine shaft. But because that shaft was so deep, this thing had to be a lot larger than its predecessors. Like, that drum is about 30 feet wide in the middle, and altogether, this equipment weighed some 1.7 million pounds. With this machine, the Quincy Mining Company could move people and rock in and out of the ground even faster. The hoist could raise a cart of rock called a skip at up to about 36 miles per hour and could carry up to 10 tons of rock per trip. In the first year alone, this thing raised the equivalent of 52,000 skips worth of rock. Also, as a nice bonus, this thing actually burned less coal than the previous steam hoist they were using. What really struck me though is that all of this was happening in the early 1900s, so there wasn't computer-aided design to help with the building of this thing, and there weren't modern, complex computers to help with the operation. There was just a whole lot of ingenuity involved. Now, operating the Nordberg hoist actually started next door. Over there, rail cars would come in full of coal. Then a worker would pull a door, the coal would spill out onto the ground in front of them, and they would shovel it into a series of boilers. Those boilers produced steam, and that steam powered the Nordberg hoist. It flooded this chamber, as well as its counterpart over on the other side of the hoist, and the pressure from the steam rocketed a piston. That piston moved a lever, and ultimately that got this entire 30-foot drum spinning and got the cable moving. One end of the cable came off the bottom of the drum, one came off the top, and ultimately they went out the building and over to the number 2 shaft rock house. But there's also more to it than that, because the Nordberg hoist actually has 2 sets of pistons. Once the steam traveled through those high pressure pistons over there, it came over into these low pressure pistons, which also fired and helped keep the drum spinning. That way, you got as much work out of your steam as possible. After that, the steam went into a compressor, where it was cooled, turned back into liquid water, and ultimately released into a pond outside. So overall, this is a really cleverly engineered, powerful machine. And what I also thought was cool was everything that went into running it.
Man, I love a good spiral staircase. Overall, operating the Nordberg hoist was kind of like running a giant elevator.
The operator would sit here and would use these levers to give the hoist some gas, so to speak, or to slow it down, or to change the direction of the drum. And as he did so, these dials would change. These dials are, maybe ironically, called miniatures, and each one corresponds to a cart attached to the cable of the Nordberg hoist. So this cart might be at level 45, being loaded up with rock from the mine. And this cart might be at level 1, dumping the rock it just pulled up. Then as the hoist ran, this cart would go up and this one would go down, and the operator could track their progress by following the hands on these dials. But here's the thing, like I mentioned, there weren't modern computers to control this whole machine, so I imagine that operating it took a bit of practice. I also learned that operators picked up some tricks along the way, like they could take advantage of gravity to make this machine as efficient as possible. See, the cable of the Nordberg hoist was heavy. Only 1 foot weighed about 4 pounds. And if you were going all the way to the bottom of the mine shaft, that could be about 9,000 feet of cable. So, you know, do some quick math. That's about 36,000 pounds. But as an operator was lowering a skip, he could take advantage of that. As more cable unwound and that whole side of the system got heavier, he could ease back on the gas, save some steam, and let gravity help pull his skip into the earth. Now, there are some safety measures in place. There are alarms and mechanisms to stop this thing from spinning too fast or from seriously overextending itself. But a lot of the responsibility was also on the operator. When the Nordberg hoist was built, it was kind of the jewel of the Quincy mine. It was a huge, powerful machine housed in a huge, beautiful building. The Quincy Mining Company spent more than $180,000 on the hoist alone, and that was in the 1910s. It's hard to say exactly how that would translate to today's money, but if you look at the hoist and what it was designed to do, you can probably ballpark its value somewhere around $100 million. But in the end, the hoist didn't run forever. It was built to last 30 to 40 years, but in the end, and only ran for about 11 before output at the Quincy Mine seriously dwindled. Even then though, this machine is a huge testament to what engineers were able to accomplish more than 100 years ago. And the machine is so complex that the people who take care of it are still learning the fine details of how it works. To be clear, they know all the big pieces, but there are still a few small mechanisms they're trying to understand. Because really, that's the thing about history. The people who built and engineered and operated the Nordberg Hoist, the people who would fully understand every detail of this machine, those people are gone now. And knowing that, I am especially grateful for all the people around here helping keep this kind of history alive. Thanks for joining me for the story, and a special thanks to the Keweenaw Convention and Visitors Bureau for supporting this video. Next week, I'll be back with another video, and this time I'm going underground to learn more about the geology of the Quincy Mine and get a taste of what it was like to be a miner here 100 years ago. I am pumped. Thanks again for being here, and I'll see you soon.